intention of Beijing. We have to really resist this kind of authoritarian rule in Hong Kong. Mr. Tony Jay, President, the national high-speed rail system is the largest in the world. It covers 20,000 kilometers. In 2020, it is estimated that it's going to going up to 30,000 kilometers, covering 80% of the major cities. The high-speed rail not only facilitates the passengers, not only will it improve connectivity between provinces, it will bring about good economic benefits. The XIL was discussed in the year 2000. 18 years have come and gone. A baby born at that time has become adult. The mainland's national rail, high-speed rail system is so convenient, it's crisscrossing the entire country. But in Hong Kong, there are still people who are doubting the relevance of the XIL, or should there be co-location, that they are filibustering and they are stalling the whole matter in Switzerland. The Lausanne Institute rated Hong Kong lower in terms of competitiveness because of all the argument, all the debates, and Hong Kong has slipped one notch. It makes sense. Now, those who are against the bill doubt the co-location arrangement. They doubt the legality. They doubt all the operational arrangement. They are concerned that human rights, liberty, rule of law, and also law enforcement and operational problems might arise. Some doubt about the ticketing arrangement and also the trial run and all the safety concerns.
We have to develop our economy. We have to seize opportunity presented by the mainland economy. We need to dovetail with the mainland transport system. The Hong Kong section of XIL is an important infrastructure project for cross-boundary transport. And the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge is going to be commissioned very soon, facilitating exchanges of goods and people. The setting up of the co-location arrangement at West Kowloon will facilitate, will make it convenient for people to go to the mainland for business, for leisure, and even for residents. If our XIL service, or if the national XIL service stops at the boundary of Hong Kong, then we'll be cut off, and mainlanders and Hong Kong people will have no access to the national XIL network. As this is going to benefit Hong Kong people, the XIL is supported by our people. If there are ticketing problems or other operational problems, electrical members should be pragmatic in seeking solutions. And then we should not, because of worries or doubts, decide to linger and do nothing or to have arguments for the sake of argument. The legal issues of XIL have been solved by the governments concerned. The MPCSC made a decision last year confirming that the cooperation agreement is legal and constitutional. We have to understand the constitutional setup under the basic law comes from the Constitution. An MPCSC is the ultimate authority for interpreting the basic law and the Constitution. If someone still thinks that this is not good enough, then they can seek redress in our courts. Instead of making circular arguments and go round and round in this council, wasting our time. In the US, in Europe, there are similar one-stop occurrence arrangements like the one we're going to have. And we have co-location of ICQ facilities in Songshan Bay. So far, we haven't heard about major problems arising from the arrangement. On the question of ticketing arrangements, I'm glad to learn that even those who oppose the XRL have asked the government to talk to the mainland authorities so as to simplify the procedure and lower the fares. It would be best if Hong Kong people, Hong Kong passengers, can buy tickets at West Kowloon Station for access to all the high-speed rail stations in the mainland. It seems that they expect the commissioning of the XRL service like other people. After the completion of all the construction of the XRLs, the government should come up with a comprehensive testing and acceptance arrangement, and also there should be contingency plans so that we can avoid the recurrence of the chaos and problems when we commissioned the new airport. So I submit. Ms. Claudia Mo.
Hey, and we're stuck in a miserable legislature. Miserable because this speed rail co-location bill is taking Hong Kong down, and taking Hong Kong down fast. Completely out of the blue, this bill declares that there's a part of Hong Kong that's simply going to be out of Hong Kong, judged as outside of Hong Kong territory. What for? For mainland laws being implemented there. You would ask, whatever happened to one country, two systems, and our very basic law? Good question. If this is not mainlandization, which I've been fearing all these years, what else could it be? The ultimate goal is to make sure that Hong Kong, as it is, disappears. It's so completely assimilated into and gobbled up by mainland China that it doesn't exist anymore. Hong Kong identity, is there such a thing at all? They're practicing homogenization in Hong Kong. It's obvious that Hong Kong used to be an international cosmopolitan city. Those were the days. And outsiders would ask, if this whole thing is considered unconstitutional by the Democrats here, why don't you guys take it to court to let the court decide first? But no, you have to see the passage of this bill first before any court would make a ruling. Or maybe we can wait till then. But again, no. By that time, if you think there's any judicial review available still on this issue, they would have asked the Hong Kong government, probably, most likely, would have asked Beijing to interpret the basic law again, or the reinterpretation of the basic law. Outsiders, many of them didn't realize this so-called many outsiders simply don't realize this so-called mini constitution in Hong Kong. It's being overridden by the NPC, the National People's Congress in Beijing. Whatever law is being found inconvenient in Hong Kong these days, they could ask that NPC, the Beijing legislature, to just rewrite it, basically. Rewrite it. That's what we really mean. Go and practice it in Hong Kong. That sums up Hong Kong today. And Hong Kong's under siege. Not too long ago, we had this issue about lead-tainted water. No one has been found culprit. And we had this issue. There's a rather horrific accident of a huge piece of roof just collapsed over a sports stadium at a university campus. No one is held responsible. And right in front of our eyes these days, we have very obvious, dirty, dishonest engineering works going on along our railway construction. Who's being taken to court? Nobody. Hong Kong, an international city? Those were the days. Now, this issue about ceding territory to mainland China. Some people would argue, oh, it's just a matter of political expediency, isn't it? It's all for the sake of convenience and things. Why do you have to be so prickly about trifles, say? What I've been thinking personally is that perhaps, that we could put up with this just once if the government, obviously, quite obviously, acting on behalf of Beijing, would actually promise that this is a one-off thing, that this is going to be the first and last time Hong Kong would be ceding territory back to mainland China, i.e. the Beijing government. No, they wouldn't even promise that, let alone guarantee that that's the happening. They wouldn't promise this is not going to be a precedent. That's double negative, i.e. this just might be a very dangerous precedent. And this is scary. And this is more than worrying. This amounts to an act of insanity on the part of the government and all its toadies. Very sadly, we see how this legislature and the government have been working hand in hand, almost hand in glove, we say. It's almost watertight, their operation. They would say we're complimenting each other only. It's not just complimenting, it's conniving. Conniving. A group of conspirators and co-conspirators. I mean, of course we can see these people, those officials, Beijing toadies, they have rails, Beijing loyal rails, and they run on them. The destination? A crash for Hong Kong. They are crushing Hong Kong. That's the cost. Regina Yip, who headed our Bills Committee, I just read the news just now, saying that she was, well, implying that she was expecting a note of thanks from the government after all that, you know, cooperation. Ha ha. That's the most tale-telling sign. And she's getting sulky, apparently. Again, according to my online news feed, she's very unhappy with the fact that the government fails to give her a note of thanks for speedily push through this bill. this most damning bill this legislature has ever seen, ever since 1997. Once again, other people would say, do you have to stick at trifles? Can't you just look at the big picture? Okay, let's forget about the number of train compartments or carriages, or as a matter of fact, the frequencies they're going to run on this high-speed rail, or the number of destinations available from Hong Kong. Or for that matter, all those emergency, financial, whatnot arrangements, never mind. But then, what about the spirit of this bill, which is to sell out Hong Kong? It's a blatant sellout. One country, two systems. They could just blend things into a lump of nebulous words, which mean nothing, and they thought, they think still they can get by, get past with it. I just can't help speaking with words of cutting contempt vis-a-vis those people who think they are with the government. In this legislature, they're not lawmakers. They think they are government officials or potential government officials. They're quite wrong. Now, of course, they could come back and say, what are you complaining about? Everything has been written on the wall. The writing's always on the wall. The fact that Democrats on this side has always been outnumbered by those Beijing stooges, I call them. So it's in the bag for them, the passage of this bill. It's already in the bag. What are you complaining about? But we need to speak up still. We're not taking this sellout lying down. We're speaking for the record, for history. Now, 10 years ago, when I first read about this co-location business, I was slightly baffled. What's the big deal about it? I thought it's all about customs, immigration, and quarantine, etc. Well, what's so horrendously important about it? And very soon, of course, I learned what all that is about. And the government knew too. And they pretended that they had done everything they could to try to make this all very reasonable. But their reasonableness, it's all made up by them or by their masters in Beijing. Something called proportionality test. Give me a break. The so-called proportionality test, as the government, I think mainly by the justice, not chief, because judges would mind that. Our secretary for justice then would say, we need to make sure that this co-location arrangement and the establishment of mainland port area, etc., would have this maintainable, sustainable system of economic development of the SAR. What's she talking about? And the second thing is we need to make sure that, once the mainland port area has been specified, the jurisdictions would need to be very clearly delineated. So that's their logic, right? They have something. They thought they need something, so something's in place. And this thing, because it's in place, we need to make sure that the two different systems and jurisdictions would be very clearly divided. Fine. And the third thing, they say, we need to keep, they actually use the word strike, striking a reasonable balance between the societal benefits of the restrictions and the inroads. Inroads is the original word I quote, made into the constitutionally protected rights of the individuals. They knew there could be such a thing as contravening individual rights. They used the word inroads into the potential rights of individuals. But what did they say in the end? Trying to convince or pretending they're trying to convince? And that is, they made all the suppositions, they made all the deliberations, and then they made all the conclusions. They say all this would carry more good than bad for Hong Kong, so we must accept it. Now, dear Hong Kong people, if we just chow down whatever Beijing has to spoon-feed us with, we're bound to choke to death. Thank you.
我提醒議員,我會大約是7點半呢。
May I remind members that I will invite the officials to reply at around 7:30, and that will end our second reading debate. Many members are still waiting to speak. May I remind you to make good use of your time so that we can accommodate as many members as possible. Mr. Arnold Kin, President, no matter how the world has changed, here I stand to oppose this unconstitutional bill. President, the collocation bill was presented to this council. I speak to oppose the second reading of the collocation bill. This morning when I spoke on the adjournment motion, I was of the view that it was against our procedural justice to examine the bill. And here, in accordance with ROP 54.3, I will focus on the principles of the collocation bill and how, on the whole, how bad it is on the whole, so that the administration could be so shameless as to have told this lie for 10 years, and I'm ashamed of it, even as a legislator. This morning, Ms. Tanya Chen talked about the process of scrutiny of the bill. And it was shown that the administration has violated the due procedures in scrutinizing this bill. When we look at the bill, we cannot but look back chronology of events in the past 10 years. In August 2005, a working group chaired by the Secretary for Transport and Housing was tasked to look at this XRL. That task force with Professor Anthony Zheng and Eva Zheng as members, I might have been disbanded even before Mr. Frank Chen became secretary. However, since 2008, we've been asking the administration the progress of the co-location arrangement and viable or feasible options that is constitutional and legal, but to no avail. In 2010, when the FC examined the funding application for the XRL, we came to know that space were they reserved at the West Kowloon terminus for co-location arrangement. But even though members pressed for an answer, administration claimed that the study was not complete. And then on the 30th of June 2017, Anthony Zheng told us that there was no definitive option for co-location arrangement yet. And all of a sudden, this lie has dealt a blow to our rule of law. In July, the government announced the three-step process to us, and then in November 2017, the agreement was signed with the Guangdong province, and the decision was made by the NPCSC in December 2017, and then very soon the bill was gazetted to let the public learn of this collocation arrangement decided on by the NPCSC. There is nothing in the long title on the background I just set out to you. It only mentioned what happened on the 18th of November and the 27th of December 2017, respectively. However, I'd like to fill in the background of the bill to you. Each step looked legal and proper, but each step was actually against due procedure. It was unconstitutional. Every step was unconstitutional. In the adjournment debate, I pointed out that the bill was against the basic law and our constitution. Under Article 11 of the basic law, all laws enacted by the legislature must not contravene the basic law. We examine this law, and this is against the constitutional duty imposed on us by the basic law. At the adjournment debate, Dr. Priscilla Leung quoted the decision of the NPCSC. She said that a decision by the NPCSC was tantamount to interpretation of the basic law. This is Ms. Adiji said this morning. They have put the party above the law. Many members have quoted the submission from the Bar Association. The bill is in contravention of the basic law. Dr. Junius Ho, I know he has strong views about quoting from the Bar Association's submission. He said that the Bar Association had no legal qualifications in the mainland, and therefore the views are not are without basis. And here's the only one from the pro-establishment camp to write to the BC to ask for amending the bill. Now, if what he said holds water, I think he has to reconsider his position, because Mr. Li Fei, who could have the final say, did not study law. Now, regarding the saving provisions and also places inside Hong Kong and outside Hong Kong, these are very innovative and they are too difficult to understand. The BC spent 3 months scrutinizing the bill, and I think we have to language familiar to the people of Hong Kong, but it would be difficult to enter the very small world of the SJ and the SCH, because officials would tend to choose a more complicated terminology and language, trying to conceal the fact that the bill has no legal basis. However, the bill would affect the general public. And Chairman of the Bill, Mrs. Regina Ho, was the one who marketed the Article 23 bill, and we have to let the bill comprehensible to ordinary members of the public. If you ask them what is meant by savings and provisions, I think it's very difficult to let them understand. Now, I will explain in layman terms how the bill goes against the spirit of the rule of law. The long title of the bill reads, declare an area as the West Kowloon Station mainland port area, to provide that a train compartment of a passenger train in operation of the Hong Kong SAR to be regarded as part of the WKS MPA. Although we enjoy the our court enjoy the power of final adjudication, now we don't know what is meant by mainland port area here. I think we have taken away the jurisdiction of our court in Hong Kong. Our court has jurisdiction over the HKMPA originally, but with the passage of this bill, the court's jurisdiction will only have the reserved items. And that is Articles 3 and 7 in the agreement. The six things in this three articles. And these items are not clearly defined yet. That being the case, how can we enjoy independent judiciary and also the power of final adjudication? The government has yet to advance cogent and convincing basis to let us support this bill. Once this bill is passed, there will be many exceptions in the future to allow mainland laws to apply to Hong Kong in ways incomprehensible to us. And the backdoor is West Kowloon. Clauses 3 and 6 of the bill is really the fore of the rule of law in Hong Kong. Many clauses in the bill are not well justified. It is hard to convince us to vote for this bill. Because of time constraint, I can only quote one more example. Clause 4 of the bill is about the area delineated and colored orange on plan number 1 and annex 1 to plan number 1 in schedule 2. And it is declared as the West Kowloon Station mainland port area. Now we have to consider these together with plan number 1 and plan numbers 2, 3, and 4 in that schedule, and with the notes on plans and annexes. In fact, we didn't have the opportunity to examine plan numbers 2, 3, and 4 in the Bills Committee. When we visited the site, we noticed that the port area had a rather long boundary, and we wanted to look at the means of escape. We were not allowed. We wanted to visit HKMPA and also the 210 means of escape. We were not allowed to do so. Mr. Frank Chen said that, well, you could put that request to us, but we had our own views. I hope I have not quoted Mr. Chen wrong.
Yesterday, I received from Mr. Frank Chen a letter addressed to the whole council, and he said that we should exercise the maximum patience and sincerity to listen to members' views and make a response. President, after such a long time, how sincere is Mr. Frank Chen? How much patience and forbearance has he exercised? 36 hours only, Mr. President. As of now, there is nothing in black and white when the 36 hours will be coming, maybe 7:30, as you said, I don't know, maybe some other time. But anyhow, the debate is going to be not long enough. President, I pointed out that outside the chamber, when you met the media, you said that the co-location bill is on the basis of the MPCSC's decision to implement the co-location arrangement in the Hong Kong SAR. Any amendments that deviate from the cooperation arrangement will be beyond the scope of the bill and therefore will not be approved. End of quote. I hope I haven't quoted you wrong. The pandemic members put forward the 75 CSAs. The CSAs to do with the cooperation arrangement were all ruled out of order. And this is a historic ruling. Why is it that so many pandemic members want to put forward the CSAs? It is because the bill presented for second reading is still fraught with so many problems, and even the legal advisor of the LegCo cannot clear it. I get the vivid impression that when the legal advisor at the Bills Committee on Co-location Bill put forward his own questions, he raised questions like why there are so many problems with the co-location bill. I'm sure that our legal advisor is not minded to challenge the administration. He's acting on the basis of his own legal expertise and raised so many questions and so many flaws that exist in the co-location bill. The administration said they respected the legal advisor's advice, but they didn't bother to change anything and presented this bill for second reading. So in the whole process, there is very limited room. I've spent 14 minutes talking about the legal issues with fellow members and the administration, but there are still many substantive problems to do with the XLL, and to this day we still haven't got a chance to discuss with the administration, not least the economic benefits. Some said that it's very convenient, there will be economic benefits. Now for the national high-speed rail system, other than the Shanghai and Beijing section, all of them are loss-making. When we talk about this XLL in Hong Kong, this is not a high-speed rail, this is at low speed. And they're causing disturbances to the residents, maybe they have to slow down even further. With these words, I object the co-location bill. Mr. Michael Look.
Thank you, Madam Deputy. Recently, the US and China have been embroiled in trade tension. What is the world order like? The mainland is the second largest economic entity. The mainland has put forward Made in China 2025, and the US is suppressing our country because of this. Now, you may say that I'm digressing, Mr. President. I must say that there is a glorious prospect for the future of China. The people of Hong Kong, especially young people, would like to ride this through train of national development and rejuvenation. There are President Xi Jinping wrote to Hong Kong scientists and said that Hong Kong does have a critical mass of talents, and they are important resources for the development of the mainland. So Hong Kong people will have ample prospect to be involved in the mainland development. The construction of a high-speed rail to link up between link up Hong Kong with the mainland would be of critical importance. At the beginning of the handover, we started talking about the rail. In 2005, the government decided that this will be developed in the form of Guangzhou-Shenzhen-Hong Kong Expressway, a railway, and funding was earmarked, and this is the project at the initiative of Hong Kong. Now, some said, opposition members said that this is something decreed by Beijing, and nothing can be further from the truth. The building of the XLR has gone through a lot of challenges and difficulties. Now, this is at the home stretch, and this hinges on the co-location bill. Whether this bill will be passed into law will determine whether the XLL will see the maximum efficiency, and whether we can achieve the 1-hour living circle in the Greater Bay Area.
So the three-step process must be a success. This is the last step. It must be a success. The opposition members are staging political show. They want to stall the XRL, and even if this goes into operation, they want it to be a slow train. And this is an act of irresponsibility, and this is wreaking havoc on Hong Kong, not just in terms of the operational losses of the system. This would deal a blow to the role of Hong Kong in the Greater Bay Area. Just imagine the XRL is built. If imagine we don't have the co-location arrangement, and Hong Kong will be regarded as very much an island. We will be navel gazing. We will be looking inward, and the XRL will become a slow train. And how would the mainland friends see Hong Kong? Hong Kong prides itself on being the Pearl of the Orient, and we have a special function, and we have the leading role in the Greater Bay Area. How can we preserve and sustain these kind of roles? And this will have a bearing on the future development of Hong Kong. And the investors will see that Hong Kong is a politically charged place, and the council here is so disconnected. So this bill has to be passed. The opposition members play down the importance of the XRL. We have one country, two systems. We have the mainland backing us, and therefore we have the XRL. If Hong Kong is an island, what's the point of having the XRL? Now, we do have the advantage of the mainland as the backup. According to some surveys, 66% of the people polled agree that we should have co-location at WKS, and this is most convenient. 56% said that co-location doesn't undermine one country, two systems. There is another survey at the beginning of the year that showed that 50% of the people polled hope that we should have co-location at WKS. We also have CUHK, HKU surveys. The findings show that there are more people in support than there are people in opposition. The opposition member said that we have to look at the public opinions. They claim that they represent the public. I think they're looking at public views as disposable. If it doesn't suit them, they say that the public members of the public are ignorant, and they claim to be the democratic members. That we're not talking about one or two opinion surveys. I hope that the pandemic members will attach importance to the public opinions. Some criticized the pandems that they should organize some high-speed trips. We don't mind if you organize some more high-speed rail trips. I mean, I don't mind even if you're doing better than the FTU. Now, there is a demand for the XRL. Why don't we make it a convenient mode of transport for the people of Hong Kong? People are finding themselves in support because the high-speed rail is a convenient mode of transport, and I don't think we should politicize it. I don't think we should be alarmist. We should not be scaremongering, and we should not be divorced from the community. There will be Greater Bay Area development, and the Greater Bay Area will be developed into a living circle, and there will be constant interaction in the different places. So without the XRL, we simply cannot achieve the one-hour living circle. So we have to do everything we possibly can to make sure that XRL will be efficient And for this to happen, we do need the co-location, otherwise it will be no different from any other through train. The high-speed rail is covering a lot of the cities, including the second, third, fourth tier cities, and we're still against this co-location. Now for the route arrangement, ticketing arrangement, there is room for improvement. Like I said, why is it that we can travel to four short-haul stations and 14 long-haul stations? I think we should expand the scope and cover as many cities as possible, 4,400 and so on. For this to happen, we do need the co-location arrangement. It's with the co-location arrangement that we can draw more patronage. It's with more patronage that we can seek more routes with the mainland authorities. So this is of critical importance. The purpose of the bill, Mr. President and Madam Deputy, is to implement the co-location arrangement at WKS. Previously, at the Shenzhen Bay Port area, we had the success story. It shows the co-location is feasible. Some opposition members said that this is a different story. The Shenzhen Bay Port lies in the mainland. A piece of land is leased to Hong Kong to the tune of dozens of hectares. Now they are leasing two stories, and they said we can lease land from mainland, but not the other way around. We understand the Shenzhen Bay Port area hasn't experienced any problems like cross-boundary enforcement, any arbitrary decision, or any arbitrary enforcement problems. It has been very effective. It shows that it's not enough just to do a CIQ. Some said that we should restrict it to a CIQ, Customs and Excise, Immigration and Quarantine, the Bureau Secretaries, THB, SB, and DOJ said that there are loopholes if we restrict it to CIQ. The Shenzhen Bay Port area is a success story. To use your logic, if we practice CIQ, there would be against the principle.
So the CIQ model is not good. So let's get a full package apart from the six reserve matters. We should have the full package. And it said that this is against one country, two system, Article 18 of Basic Law, that is to say national laws shall not be applied in Hong Kong SAR except those listed in Annex 3. The government has explained very clearly, and I won't need to repeat it. It seems that they don't have the notion of one country. It's difficult to understand the co-location if you don't have this notion of one country. That's why they have been talking about ceding land for co-location and slogans like that, as if Hong Kong is a sovereign state and an independent sovereign state. It's important for Hong Kong to cede land to the mainland, because Hong Kong is part of China. Some people are stubborn and they don't want to accept co-location. So whatever you may do to provide assurances, ultimately it's a question of trust. Without the authorization from the CPG, we don't have one country, two system. Now this would involve three steps. First, that's the signing of the cooperation agreement. Second, the approval, the agreement of the MPCSC, and then local legislation to follow. So it's okay if the MPCSC has given us the green light. And let's suppose that if some people think that this is against the basic law, then the proper redress should be to seek a judicial review in our courts. But so far, I haven't heard about this. because they are concerned that they will fail in seeking judicial review. But then they will be proved wrong. If they are really confident that this is against the basic law, well, you should do it quickly. If you really think that this is not in compliance with the basic law, but they know, I think it's because they know that this is not right. They just want this council to be a forum for the debate as if it's a court. Point of order? I've heard Mr. Luk Chung Hong for a long, long time. I haven't heard about proposal of judicial review from any member. But you can seek clarification from the member. I want Mr. Luk, you should stand up after Mr. Luk has spoken. Well, they should go to seek a judicial review if they think they are right. Don't just pull up a political show here and filibuster. And if you win in your judicial review, the government would act in accordance with law. The FTU and I support the collocation bill. We support the commissioning of XRL as scheduled. We hope in the future the XRL will be as efficient as possible. We'll follow up matters such as a ticketing arrangement, whether concessionary fares can be offered, whether we can have more direct services so that the XRL service is the highest, is the most efficient that we can get, so that we can enjoy the fruits of this project. And we hope in the future the government would disclose more information such as the sharing of the costs of running the MPA. The government should be more transparent. With this remark, I support the second reading of the bill. Mr. Junius Ho. Madam Deputy, we are having the second reading debate on the collocation bill. So we are ever moving closer to the commissioning of XRL. I expect the XRL to be commissioned in the third quarter of this year, and we would be able to, should be able to complete the scrutiny in the 36 hours framework set by the president. We should be pragmatic. We should ensure the timely passage of this bill. The nearer to the passage of this bill, the more the opposition camp would try to sabotage the process. They would give misleading information, such as this bill is presented to serve the interests of MPSC, and that the party is regarded as superior to the law. All these are irrelevant. The opposite is true. We want the XRL to connect with a mainland network, and the MPCSC has to make a decision. It's one of the steps in the three-step process. The opposition is trying to delay this, and they have criticized the bill. They just want to delay the whole process. We cannot allow them to endlessly argue about this. The collocation arrangement is urgently needed. In the debate, we have heard from the opposition views and amendments. Some of them are meaningful, but the majority are not normal amendments. Before today's meeting, the 75 amendments were moved by the opposition, most of them meaningless. Some are really absurd. And the president has allowed 24 amendments to be listed for the committee to consider. For example, in the Mr. Chen Jiqun proposed a penalty clause. That is, if the mainland personnel of the MPA enters Hong Kong port area, then the person is committed an offence and would be liable to a fine of $10 million and 10 years in imprisonment. Well, that's an even more severe punishment for a drug trafficker. If such an amendment is passed, would you like the mainland to do the same? And if Mr. Chen Jiqun does something that violates the mainland system, he will be fined $10,000 and sent to prison for 10 years. Such amendments really don't stand up to reasoning. We have had sufficient time to discuss the bill, and the opposition can make use of the time available, could have made use of the time available, but they did not do this. They did not offer positive and productive comments and suggestions. Instead, they are working against the interests of the people by filibustering. They want to achieve political aims. They are going against public opinion. They are resorting to every means to stop the passage of the bill. Well, they are advancing the unreasonable views and distorted arguments. It's said that having the MPA in West Kowloon Station is ceding land, and it's also not in line with the Article 18 of the Basic Law. And they stress the so-called opinion from the Hong Kong Bar Association as if it's the only valid argument. All other arguments are superfluous and not valid. Under the principle of one country, two systems, Hong Kong is part of China, and it's set out very clearly in the Basic Law. There's no way you can say this is ceding land. And the co-location arrangement is not in violation of Article 18, in that applying national laws in the mainland port area will only be limited to that area, and it will only be enforced by the mainland authority personnel stationed there, and only XRL passengers will be affected. It will in no way violate the Basic Law. On the 27th of December 2017, MPCSC approved the cooperation agreement. And before that, full consideration has been given to the matter. The MPA will be regarded as will be deemed as part of the mainland. So it's both legal and constitutional. The decision of the MPCSC is supreme. It has a certain standing in the Basic Law in our constitutional system. And the opposition is trying to obstruct the commissioning of the XRL. They are just trying to drag the feet. They have stressed the views of the Hong Kong Bar Association as if only the views of the Bar Association are authoritative. So are you not really stubborn and biased here? The Hong Kong Bar Association is not a judicial organ. It doesn't have the power to interpret the Basic Law. None of the 25 executive committee members have Chinese law qualifications, and they have not got any expertise in the Basic Law. Well, they are saying that the MPCSC expressing views as if it's the views will represent the law, but actually they are thinking that the bar association views represent the law, and if they say so, then that's the case. Time is running very tight for the bill to be passed before the end of this current legislative session. The attitude of the opposition has shown their true colors. They are not trying to promote the well-being and interests of Hong Kong. Actually, they are trying to prevent Hong Kong from making progress. So people wonder, well, what's their intention? What's their motive? Madam Deputy, in Hong Kong, we need members who are sincere in serving the interests of Hong Kong. They should contribute to the community. There are lots of things that members can do. If there's a difference of opinion, well, let's speak our mind. Please try to convince others the best you can. But I don't want to see people who resort to ulterior motive, who are trying to distort in our rules of procedures. Well, they know well that they will lose at the end, but they just want to delay things. Ms. Tanya Chan said they would like to let Hong Kong people know that they have done the best to safeguard the interests of Hong Kong. Well, that's understood. Do your best to make the best arguments as to the best of your ability. But we don't need an adjournment debate. We know the end result well in advance. It's going to be futile, and your ugly attitude would become the part of the history. We should show our best abilities, not to show our ugly faces and let the records in history show that.
The spend of efforts to do what you're supposed to do. This is legislature. In October 2016, we saw how members who did not meet the standards in taking their oaths, and they were disqualified subsequently. We have to ensure that the overall interest of Hong Kong is served and to adhere to the standards acceptable to Hong Kong. So what we need here, President, is to serve Hong Kong with sincerity. We want legislators that can serve Hong Kong wholeheartedly and do constructive things. Through the passage of the collocation bill, we have completed a job very important. President, I support the second reading of the Guangzhou-Shenzhen-Hong Kong Express Rail Link collocation bill. Thank you. Dr. Helena Wong. Madam Deputy, I speak to oppose the second reading of the Guangzhou-Shenzhen-Hong Kong Express Rail Link Collocation Bill. In my earlier speech, I said that it was not about whether we supported the XRL or whether we were going to ride it. Rather, it is about the West Kowloon terminus in Hong Kong and also the collocation arrangement. There are constitutional challenges we have to cope with, so we have to be focused. We have to focus on the constitutional aspect. In the Bills Committee, we held public hearings to receive deputations. The Law Society and the Bar Association came to express their views, although Dr. Junius Ho said that the Bar Association views could be set aside. We don't have to attach so much significance to their views. I fail to understand how come we always set a lot of store by professional views, and how come the Bar Association, being an important legal body, can be ignored. The SJ and the administration has not answered questions posed by the Bar Association and members properly. The Democratic Party is against the second reading debate of the bill. This is because we care for issues related to the basic law. And if we pass the bill, as I have said many a times, we would at least breach three articles. First, Article 18 of the basic law, which says that national laws will not be enforced in Hong Kong. Well, this is very important. This is critical to whether we can continue to have one country, two systems. If national laws are to be applied in Hong Kong, then only laws related to defense and foreign affairs and listed in Annex 3 can be applied. But if the bill is passed, we will be applying national laws on the second, third, and fourth levels, and even train compartments and the escalators. We will make them mainland port area. Geographically speaking, the area is within the Hong Kong SAR under one country, two systems. However, the area has been taken out. The basement of the West Kowloon Terminus have been taken out from Hong Kong, and you change the name and you don't call it Hong Kong anymore, or it is MPA within the territory of Hong Kong. It is a very dangerous move. We find it difficult to explain to students and children. In the past, we told children that the Shenzhen River is a boundary. The south of Shenzhen River is Hong Kong. And all of a sudden, the first, except for the ground floor and the first floor of West Kowloon Station, the area is no longer Hong Kong. It falls within the location of Hong Kong, but it is not governed by Hong Kong. So Article 18 says the national laws shall not be applied in the SAR except for those listed in Annex 3 of the Basic Law. Now, if the bill is passed, then beneath West Kowloon Station, we will have a place which is different from the other parts of Hong Kong. Mainland laws were applied there, and it's not just about laws on CIQ or ICQ. Other things or other mainland laws were applied there. That means the jurisdiction of Hong Kong is cut. And Article 19 of the Basic Law is also relevant. Article 19 says that Hong Kong enjoys independent judicial power, including that of final adjudication. But if we have taken out the MPA, where mainland laws would be applied, then the court's jurisdiction is also undermined, and this consequence must not be overlooked. And if the bill is passed, Article 22 of the Basic Law will also be affected. Article 22 says that no department of the CPG and no province, autonomous region, or municipality may interfere in the affairs of Hong Kong SAR. And if all officers set up in the SAR by departments of the CPG shall abide by the laws of the region. So Articles 18, 19, and 22 are important bases of one country, two systems. We are talking about demarcation, areas where Hong Kong laws shall be applied, and areas where mainland laws shall be applied. In Hong Kong, we have our own laws. We have laws of the Hong Kong SAR. But with the passage of the bill, we are creating a new area that is in violation of Articles 18, 19, and 22. If we ignore this demarcation, in fact, we rely on this demarcation to protect the SAR. SAR is a policy established by Deng Xiaoping, and this is also the spirit of the Basic Law. Central officials and the pro-establishment members always ask us to uphold the Basic Law and to respect it. And the DP subscribes to this view entirely. We respect one country, two systems. However, this bill will remove the demarcation between the two places. There is a backdoor open. The bill is so controversial because it is not just about whether we can ride XRL and go to sightseeing in the mainland more efficiently. There are serious issues that we have to tackle. I think we understand that there is still Article 18 in the Basic Law. It is in the preamble of Chapter 1. It says that no law enacted by the legislature, including this bill, which is receiving its second reading debate, of the Hong Kong SAR shall contravene the Basic Law. Under Article 11 of the Basic Law, no law enacted by this legislature shall convene the Basic Law. But we are violating Articles 18, 19, and 22. Although the SJ tried to explain in the Bills Committee that there is no contravention because you have to buy tickets and enter the MPA of the West Kowloon Station. Nobody forces you to enter the MPA. If you don't go in, you will not be affected. So long as the laws are not applied to the whole territory of Hong Kong and not to everyone in Hong Kong, that is allowed. Law enforcement officials of the mainland can apply mainland laws to people who have chosen to enter MPA. This is so baffling. Since when have we adopted such an understanding of the law? Since when have we singled out a certain place where as soon as you walked in, the national laws or mainland laws will apply? These are constitutional difficulties yet to be overcome. Dr. Junius Ho and some other members, such as Mr. Lok Chung Hong, said in a very agitated manner that if you don't like the law, you can seek a judicial review as soon as it is passed. Although we understand that the judiciary has jurisdiction over a judicial review against a law passed by this legislature, we believe that after the bill is passed, there may be people who seek a judicial review. So if this law is challenged, we cannot preempt the court's ruling. If the court says that the law is against the Basic Law and it has to be abolished, and I think it's quite likely that even before the CFA makes a ruling, the NPCC will intervene by means of an interpretation of the law. We will be opening the door to invite another round of interpretation of the Basic Law by the NPCC. Of course, this is not the first time the NPCC interprets the Basic Law. I believe if the bill is passed, it's likely that we will have another interpretation of this law by the MPCSC. The government has had 10 years to consider alternatives to overcome the constitutional difficulties. The Bar Association, as well as Mr. Shek Wing Tai, have said that there are two ways to overcome the difficulties. Either you can amend Annex 3 of the Basic Law and put important provisions into the Annex. Well, this is actually quite worrying, because if areas that fall entirely within the jurisdiction of Hong Kong that are not related to defense and foreign affairs are put into Annex 3, that is worrying. Another option is to amend the Basic Law. When the Basic Law was drafted in the mid-1980s, and when it was promulgated in the 1990s, the country or the SL government did not have the intention to extend the XRL into West Kowloon. If because of new developments and with the consent of the community and after consulting the Basic Law Committee, we amend the Basic Law, that is a better option than the current approach. We pay lip service to respect of the Basic Law when we have a bill that actually contravenes it. As legislators, we cannot support any bill that contravenes the Basic Law. And this is the reason why we cannot support a second reading of the bill. It's not a must that we oppose the XRL. We are against anything that will undermine one country, two systems, and the jurisdiction of our court. If we introduce mainland laws into Hong Kong territory, this is going to do a heavy blow to one country, two systems. So to play safe, DP urges the administration to withdraw the bill and see whether we can have another way out that is constitutional, so that we can deal with the collocation arrangement of the XRL. I oppose the second reading of the bill.
Dr. Ching Chung Tai, thank you, Madam Deputy. Regarding the Guangzhou-Shenzhen-Hong Kong Express Rail Link Collocation Bill, I'm against the second reading. I don't propose to spend too much time to state the reasons for objecting to the bill. We've been discussing this for quite some considerable time. It goes back to 2009, when the XRL was vehemently objected to. So I'm going to spend my 10-odd minutes. I may not use up to 15 minutes. I'm not particularly happy about the situation. As an opposition member, or what I consider to be an opposition member, we cannot support anything that will be undermining the basic law like this co-location bill. What is more important is that we are against the construction of high-speed rail. Madam Deputy, are you looking for your phone, which is ringing? Any regime wants to create some icons in their territories. The colonial government attaches more importance to that. Before 1997, the UK government consciously or unconsciously built a lot of icons. They built the Star Ferry, the Statue Square, the insignia in the post boxes, and so on.
Before and after 1997, the people of Hong Kong, in particular in the universities, many of the intellectuals would feel that Hong Kong would be turning from a colonial place to a decolonized place. And with decolonization, Hong Kong people will be able to govern Hong Kong themselves. From the colonial system to decolonization, we may not need all these symbols, the Star Ferry, the Statue Square, or the poster boxes or the insignia on the policeman's hat. And we have moved on from the fishing village to more civilized society. From 1997 to 2007, for the 10 years I was educated here in Hong Kong, we had we were under the impression that that decolonization process was smooth. And in the year 2000, when we started discussing the XRL, that was the turning point. We were not moving on from a colonial city to a decolonized city and move on to a civilized, sensible society. Instead, we are moving into another colonized place. The XRL is a symbol of this recolonization. What we face is not so much the architecture that is tasteful. We are having like something like Wahab Shek in West Kowloon. In 2009, we had the myth that we would have the infrastructure projects to drive economic development. We cannot go back to 2009, we cannot turn the clock back, but in 2009, well, we saw the opposition, we saw the resistance movement emerging. That was the turning point. And it was the League of Social Democrats, and then the People Power. And over the years, we saw this council resistance. And in 2009, they started talking about the construction of the XRL, and this bill is going to be passed today. And we saw the emergence of the resistance movement, and now this is falling by the wayside. If we engage in eloquent debate with you about this blue bill, there are 8 clauses, and they're very simple, very straightforward, and indeed they are absurd. Clause 6. Laws and jurisdiction in mainland port area. 1, except for reserved matters. I'm not sure why they can be reserved matters. What about the cleaner in the toilet? She can be part of the reserved matters. A, the application of the laws of the mainland and of laws of Hong Kong and the mainland port area. B, the delineation of jurisdiction, including jurisdiction of the courts over the mainland port area. And this is lying outside Hong Kong within the mainland. In this bill 6.1b, I don't quite understand why this includes the jurisdiction of the courts. I carve out a place for you. Why do you want to take away the jurisdiction of the courts in Hong Kong? If we delve into this bill, I think it's a waste of breath. If you look at the global picture, I have to talk about BL18. I have to talk about the non-compliance with so many provisions in the Basic Law. This is one of the arguments. But the thing is, why don't we stop and have a look? Now, we started having resistance against the XRL in 2009, back in the old chamber. was it Eva Cheng at that time? She was the Secretary for Transport and Housing. At that time, they thought about a successful conclusion for the resistance movement. There were tens of thousands of people surrounding the council, and there was resistance both inside and outside the council, and they stopped the funding proposals dead in its track. But some said that it was okay to build the XLL as long as they don't impose the co-location. Madam Deputy, I have a vivid memory. In 2009, it was the last year of my doctorate endeavor. I spent a year in Dongguan, and there was the resistance movement. I was coming to the tail end of my dissertation, and I went to join the resistance movement. In 2001, I graduated as a doctor, and I decided to come back to Hong Kong because of the problems with XLL. Now, this is symbolic of the fact that Hong Kong is not moving from the colonial to decolonization, and then Hong Kong people ruling Hong Kong. In fact, what we are facing is recolonization. When Hong Kong was colonized, there was a night market. I heard that the UK government wrote a letter to the first governor of Hong Kong and told him that Hong Kong was a colony that didn't look like a colony. It seems to be true. Other than Hong Kong, it seems that there are no other places that are as peaceful and as good order as Hong Kong was. Hong Kong was under colonial rule. We had liberty, despite the autocratic rule. In the 1980s, we had the local movement emerging, and we faced the uncertainties about Hong Kong's future. And all of us seemed to experience a period when Hong Kong had good order. And after 1989, we hoped that Hong Kong would no longer be a colony. But this XLL is telling us that this is situated in right at the heart of the town center, which is really unsightly. Now you have the Wisdom Path on Lantau, and this is not enough, and they're putting this XLL right at the heart of Hong Kong. You may say that these colonial buildings or structures, they may not look good, like in the 1980s. We were criticizing the cultural center in TST, and it is criticized for looking like a toilet. Matthias Wu always said this: you can criticize the colonial government for putting something unsightly there, and we criticized it in the 1990s. Those from the pro-establishment camp would know that towards the end of the colonial rule, they tried to pull a fast one, and they decided to build a rose garden at West Kowloon. And they tried to put this rose garden at West Kowloon. Now, because of the political situation, that didn't come to pass. But there are many different camps that feel that it would not be enough to build the Rose Garden there. It would be far better to put the XLL there. So it's from 2009, it was decided to put the high-speed rail at West Kowloon, and that was a wrong step. That was the major wrong and misstep in Hong Kong after the handover. This is not called decolonization. I noticed you spent 11 minutes, and basically you are speaking against the XLL. Why don't you speak on the co-location bill? Thanks very much, Madam Deputy, for reminding me of the time. So in 2009, it was decided that XLL would be built. We thought that the resistance forces realized that the colonial buildings, the unsightly buildings, will be put there for sure. I went back. I come back to this co-location bill now. It is not enough. They think that this is not sufficient, unsightly. They are telling the people of Hong Kong that this bulk is not for adornment. It is for a useful purpose. You may not need this kind of infrastructure, but they are trying to make Hong Kong and the mainland inseparable, or to put it lightly, they will be mutually independent. But 10 years ago, we thought that the river water will not be interfering with the sea water, and it would be okay just to talk about interests. But with this XLL, with this bill, co-location bill, to be frank, there is no need for us to go into detail about the provisions, because at the end of the day, it's all about who is calling the shot. If you're merely talking about the interests, people can't be bothered about the Greater Bay Area. Why are we concerned about this bill? Because in this MPA, it is situated right at the heart of Hong Kong, and they're telling us that there are some reserved matters, there are some non-reserved matters, and there are certain issues that Hong Kong would have no control over. 61B, I respond to Mr. Michael, look, why is it that the Penn Dams would not consider judicial review? If you understand this provision, 61B, you would then understand that the MPA includes the jurisdiction. Once this has been delineated, then that there will be no power for judicial review. This will be stripped of Hong Kong. So from this very point, I want to simply point out that we don't need to talk about money in opposition to this bill. We don't need to talk about the economic benefits. All these are projections. All we need to do is to think of one question. If there is any casualty in the MPA, who will be held responsible? Who will be responsible for the damages? With the passage of this bill, there are still so many uncertainties in West Kowloon. There is a water seepage. If there is a torrential downpour, who is going to be responsible for the water seepage? Under the bill, it will be Hong Kong's responsibility, but who will be held responsible for the damages? Nothing is clear in this, so I'm against the second reading. Thank you.
Mr. Tommy Jung, Madam Deputy, in and out of this council, there have been questions about the co-location arrangement. The Bar Association has stated its position, and during the scrutiny of the bill, the Bar Association submitted written views to the Bill's committees, reiterating that the bill is against basic law, and they urge us not to pass the bill. So they asked us to vote against the bill during the second reading, but the Liberal Party begs to differ. Now, without delineating the boundaries through a dimming provision, legal means are adopted to take some parts of Hong Kong out of the jurisdictions of Hong Kong. So we say this is taking a certain part of land out of Hong Kong, but in the community they call it ceding land. The Bar Association stresses that the establishment of the mainland port area at West Kowloon Station is totally different from setting up a Hong Kong port area in Shenzhen Bay Port. First of all, Shenzhen Bay is not within the boundaries of Hong Kong. And also there are clauses in the Shenzhen Bay Port Ordinance for the Shenzhen Bay is not part of Hong Kong, but with agreements signed between the Shenzhen authorities and the Hong Kong authorities, Hong Kong laws are applicable in certain parts, and that's under the jurisdiction of Hong Kong. for the West Kowloon Station at the mainland port area that's situated within Hong Kong. Apart from what's stated in Annex 3, apart from laws listed in Annex 3, all national laws shall not be applicable to Hong Kong, that's stated in basic law. Now, it's claimed that Clause 6, 1B is going around Annex 3, so mainland laws not applicable to Hong Kong. And that is a question of whether we are in accordance with Article 3, with the basic law. Perhaps it's a matter of interpretation of Article 18. This is not a matter that can be dealt with an agreement between the Hong Kong and mainland authorities. The Bar Association says that the MPCSC decision is not part of the basic law. And it is also not an interpretation of basic law. So the MPCSC decision does not give a constitutional basis for the co-location arrangement. Under the circumstance, if this council passes the bill, it is irresponsible. So going by the logic of the Bar Association, if mainland personnel conducts some on-board clearance, that's actually not allowed according to the Bar Association logic. So there has to be a separate location of the clearance facilities. Now, on the economic benefits and of the XRL Bar Association says that it has no specific position on that. Now, the legal profession always says that the basic law is a living tree, so it has to change with circumstances. On relationship between Hong Kong and the mainland, I see this as a straitjacket that will stand in the way of any changes. I'm not a legal professional, and of course, I'm in no position to respond to the views of the Bar Association in future. If someone launches a judicial review, then someone will certainly quote from the Bar Association. Now, in the Bar Association's position, certainly the views of some in Hong Kong, but under one country, two systems, and the basic law, Hong Kong has a unique position to defend Hong Kong's unique position. We need to make sacrifices from time to time to maintain international confidence in Hong Kong. But then the question here is whether we just remain rigid and have no regard to changes in some senses and would not respond to these changes. In that case, can we maintain international investors' confidence in us? The bill, you know, is a product of careful considerations to achieve co-location. The general public adopt a wait-and-see attitude on the whole, but at the same time, they want to see the early commissioning of the XRL. So can we then say that there is wide public support of the co-location arrangement for the XRL? Now, the public asks what Hong Kong, we can do more under the current framework. Well, there are also questions of whether international investors would be worried or would choose to take the XRL just because there were mainland personnel enforcing the laws in a certain part of the West Kowloon Station. Would they then just choose to take the plane instead of the XRL? Now, in 2006, the MPCSC made a decision on setting up the Hong Kong port area in Shenzhen Bay. At the time, Chen Zhuo made some explanations, and then Qiao Xiaoyang also gave explanations of that. And then in 2017, MPCSC endorsed the cooperation arrangement for the co-location. And then Zhang Xiaoming also gave explanations on the decision. We can see that the constitutional focus of the SMPC, of the CBG, is not something familiar to people of Hong Kong. The CBG is concerned about, cares about the central authorities giving powers or empowering the arrangement. We have to consider the uniqueness of Hong Kong, but they will also have to consider the interests of other places. So under the circumstances, they That's how they arrive at the co-location arrangement. Now the MPCSC, the State Council, and have worked together. But some say they have may have overlooked the reason. If we may have overlooked the reasonable role of Shenzhen and Guangzhou. Now it's the Shenzhen government that's always has proposed a co-location, and how would that benefit Shenzhen and Guangdong? So sometimes we just don't look at issues from other people's angles. Is that good for the long-term future of Hong Kong? In principle, we could make reference to the Eurostar arrangement for involving the UK, France, and so on. There could be two interchange stations at Shenzhen North and Guangzhou South, and there could be custom clearance facilities, the CIQ facilities there, with personnel from both places stationed there to carry out the clearance. Now, there are actually precedents for customs clearance after people move enter another territory, but then this arrangement may undermine the benefits of the $90 billion investment in the XRL. For passengers going to other places, they all have to disembark in Shenzhen, and that will undermine the benefits of direct link between, say, Hong Kong and Beijing or other mainland cities. So that's not part of the plans of the XRL. In 2009, this council endorsed the funding for the Hong Kong section of the XRL. The West Kowloon station's designs taken fully into account the co-location arrangement. There were two former secretaries for justice on the legal framework on co-location arrangement. These secretaries explored various possibilities. The bill today is the result of many years of study. The government announced a three-step process for the co-location arrangement. That this is to provide a firm legal basis for the co-location arrangement. So shall we vote in support for this new stage of the XRL? And that's because then we're also voting for the future of Hong Kong. Thank you. Mr. Yip Kim Yun. Madam Deputy, before I go into my speech, can I spend a bit of time on the arrangement? Mr. President, Mr. Andrew Leung, said at 1 p.m. today that he will allow the second reading debate to go till 7:30 p.m. That's to show that he will handle the arrangement with flexibility. Now, if all members use up their 15 minutes, 7.5 hours means only 26 members could speak. And I note that 35 members are queuing up to speak. At 4:30, the president reminded members to be concise, but I think that's putting the horse before the cart before the horse. Mr. Queen, you, Mr. Kim, can you pause for a moment, please? Actually, I reminded you earlier when you spoke, this session is not about commenting on the president's ruling. If you have different views on the president's ruling, you're welcome to communicate with him after the on another occasions, or you can express your views to the press. This debate is about whether you support the co-location bill, so please focus on the bill. Yes, I know. That's why I said we'll only spend a little bit of time on that. Because I also I actually have a request to make, so please allow me a little bit of time to finish what I'm saying. Now, initially, there was no time limit for member speeches, but eventually we want to be more effective, so there's a 15-minute time limit. So 15-minute time limit is already a way to ensure members speak in a concise manner. And this is to give to be sure that members have equal opportunity to speak. I see we have just about 100 minutes from 7:30, but there are still 16 members in the queue. If all members will speak, we're just talking about another 2 more hours. Why is it that the president won't allow them to speak? So we want to be fair. That's the spirit we want to keep to. So I hope the president will allow all members a chance to speak in this debate. Madam Deputy, I'm speaking in opposition to the second reading of the collocation bill. In fact, I'm against the entire bill. As the Democratic camp has said repeatedly, this bill is unconstitutional. Article 18, paragraph 2 of the Basic Law states that the national law shall not be applied in the Hong Kong CR except for those listed in Annex 3 to this law. So this provision is specific, but for the expediency of the XRL, the government is sacrificing the basic law. So jurisdiction is given over to another place. And that's why mainland laws could be applied in the port area at West Kowloon Station. I'm sure you all see as a real and serious danger of this being unconstitutional. Now, many have quoted the views of the Bar Association today, and we need to give due importance to the Bar Association's submissions. And of course, many can see that the bar associations did not just invent those views. Many actually share their views on the 27th of December last year. The bar association stated in its submission that if we have this law, if we say that these mainland laws are not to apply to all people in Hong Kong, so it's allowed, then it's against the interpretation of Article 18. Now, I think we all know that. If, say, one day we regard, say, the Hong Kong part or the Kowloon part as an area lying outside of Hong Kong but within the mainlands, then mainland laws could be applied there. I'm sure you will all find that unacceptable.
Of course, you may say that a special approach has been taken in relation to the West Kowloon Station, but as far as the laws are concerned, if the law allows a special approach to be taken again and again, then this may set a precedent and this may narrow down the public's rights and freedom safeguarded in the basic law. Not only the general public would be affected. According to Article 18.2 of the basic law, the courts of the Hong Kong SAR shall have jurisdiction over all cases in the region. And this article or this requirement will also be undermined. Very soon in Hong Kong, we will see a scenario in which an area is within the Hong Kong territory, but then because of the MPA, the courts of Hong Kong have no jurisdiction over those cases. And this is also a move that will undermine the judicial independence and the legal system in Hong Kong. Well, a rationale the government always cited is that the MPCSC has made the decision and that collocation arrangement is not unconstitutional. On the face of it, this seems to be a valid argument because the NPCSC has the highest power as a state organ. However, on closer scrutiny, we'll find a major problem. First of all, if the NPCSC is the constitutional body, bound by the PRC laws and the PRC constitution, the NPCSC must not arbitrarily use its power. This power comes from Article 67 of the Constitution of the PRC. So regarding the powers that the NPCSC may exercise over Hong Kong, there are various articles in the Basic Law that touch upon it, starting from Article 17 of the Basic Law, which mentions local enactment, Article 18 regarding national laws applicability in Hong Kong, and then Article 20 about the powers granted by the NPC, and about Article 90 about the appointment of the CFA Justice 158 and 159, as well as Article 160 about the laws that are considered to be against the Basic Law when the Hong Kong SAR was established, as well as Annexes 1 and 2 method for the selection of chief executive and the legislature. So clearly, their powers are confined by these articles of the Basic Law, which means that the NPCSC's power is restricted. Well, in Chong Fung Yun case 2001, Mr. Justice Sito, the presiding judge, ruled that only the law interpretation mechanism enshrined in Article 158 of the Basic Law could make an NPCSC's interpretation of the local legislation binding. In other words, the local courts can review the NPCSC's decision. In the appellant court, this decision is confirmed and is followed by later cases. So when it comes to the NPCSC's decision to approve the cooperation arrangement, nothing is mentioned about using the Basic Law or the Constitution as the basis. It only says that the NPCSC is of the view that the cooperation arrangement is in line with the Basic Law, in line with the principle of one country, two systems, and also in line with the Hong Kong SAR's Basic Law. So it is in line with the Constitution and also the Basic Law. However, not a single article of these two pieces of constitution is cited. So this legal basis is really shaky. The government ignores the Bar Association's comments. On the contrary, throughout the legislative process, the chair of the Bills Committee and president of this council have explored various means to make sure that the bill will be passed as early as possible before July. They have totally regarded the judicial challenge that may be filed in the near future. I don't think this is a responsible way of enacting local laws. We'll be facing a major crisis, which means that in the future that we would be challenged judicially. And in the community, the perception is that because of the shaky legal basis, there would be generally a lack of respect of the position. After announcing the collocation arrangement by the government, the community has actively looked into the government's proposal. Some suggestions include alternatives, for example, collocation in Futian, onboard clearance, separate clearances, or clearances in the north for northbound passengers, and also CIQ facilities in WKS. That means mainland personnel should only be responsible for customs, immigration, and quarantine procedures. This is also the approach adopted by the UK-France model. Well, some members mentioned today that for the CIQ model, that is the UK-France model, it is the same as collocation. that is the same as CIQ, but not the same as this collocation arrangement. I think we should seriously consider these alternatives, only that we have not been given the opportunity to do so. 8 years ago, the funding application for XRL was floated, and there was a suggestion whether the co-location facilities should be set up in Kamsheng Road Station. Well, I thought that was a good idea, but then it was never further taken forward. The government then insisted that no further public consultation was necessary. The government insisted that the bill should be tabled as soon as possible. As a result, all these feasible alternatives could not be discussed. As a representative of the education sector, Madam Deputy, I would report that we conducted some surveys. In October last year, we conducted some an internal poll. We surveyed 835 respondents, and over 40% of respondents supported collocation arrangements. The polling result was similar to other surveys, over 50% support. But at the same time, the 65% of respondents believe that the government should conduct public consultation. And the majority agreed that consultation is important. And without consultation, the public's confidence in one country, two systems would be undermined. So even for those who support co-location, they also agree that public consultation is essential. And we need to go through the whole procedures before we can have confidence in one country, two systems. That is why it's a lesson for all of us. Madam Deputy, in the face of major issues, very often we should consider whether to conduct public consultation or not. One interesting phenomenon is this. Very often when there is a major issue which we think public consultation should be conducted, very often, even after public consultation is conducted, it results in nothing, such as universal retirement protection, standard working hours, abolition of the MPF offsetting mechanism. Well, I hope there would be some progress regarding this issue. But for issues of major controversy that may affect the public's rights, sometimes the government may insist not to conduct a public consultations, such as the XRL or the Northeast NT development. Now, regarding co-location arrangement, I think there should be extensive and open public consultation, because without that, there would be a huge divide in society and distrust. I hope that the government can mend its ways. I so submit.
Mr. Jeffrey Lam, I'm glad to see that this express rail co-location bill finally resumed its second reading. We hope that we can expedite the legislative process to allow the early implementation of the co-location arrangement. There's some voice in the community that are very against integration with the mainland. Regardless, no matter how many advantages the XRL has, to them, they're all drawbacks. And all I suspect there are grand conspiracies behind it. Since they had taken a position prior, regardless of the importance, with extensive public support, they decided to smear this XRL and obstruct getting into everyone's way. Traffic infrastructure is the basic condition for the smooth flow of people and goods. With an extensive traffic network that will close the distance between people. In the next few months, the Hong Kong section of the XRL and the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge will be commissioned. Especially, the XRL will connect us to the national rail network, greatly improve our transport capabilities. Deputy Hong Kong need XRL more than the other way around. The national XRL network right now has exceeded 22,000 kilometers. And from the four horizontal to four vertical lines expand to eight horizontal and verticals. Very soon it will reach for 45,000 kilometers. It is anticipated that very soon it will reach 45,000 kilometers. The high-speed rail network connecting the major cities have also boosted the development of coastal areas, and whether for business or leisure, it will become a lot more convenient. When the high-speed rail has spread all corners of the country and is connected to the northwest part of the country, if the southern part of the network only connected to Shenzhen and not to Hong Kong, how we call ourselves an international city? We could probably become a backwater city. To maximize its convenience and facilitate passengers' flow, of course, we'll not ask the passengers to bring their luggages into and out of the trains for immigration clearance. The co-location allowed the passengers to complete the immigration clearance at the West Kowloon Station and begin their trip comfortably. Within an hour, they can reach Guangzhou. And within a short time, we can get to different cities in China, which is very convenient. Madam Deputy, some members criticized in the collocation and the collocations and claims that they will anticipate all sorts of problems would arise. For example, the smuggling of firearms or become some kind of a terror train. I remember at the commissioning of the Chiang Lai Kok Airport, there was initial chaos and we criticized as a white elephant project. After some teething problems, the new airport has not only been running smoothly and we frequently crowned it as one of the best airports in the world. And now that we're building the third runway to tie in with the increasing cargo and passenger volumes. For any major traffic infrastructure, there will be teething problems. However, that doesn't mean that the infrastructure is not necessary or a failure. I understand the community concerns that at the early commissioning phase, were there any defects or concern about the train schedules, the CIQ procedures, as well as the ticketing issues. We can perfectly understand the community concerns. I hope that we can have more confidence and trust our laws and institutions that through negotiations, I'm sure that the problems can be resolved. Some members of the public have told us that whether it's a three-step process or how many steps, you just want to save time so that they could have an easier trip back to their homeland. It's just troubling and they try to leave their train compartments for immigration procedures. I'm sure this view is shared by many in the public. So plenty of opinion polls have shown the public support for the co-location arrangement and agree that only the co-location would allow it to maximize its effectiveness. Some members have always reiterated they're speaking for the public. However, I think they're not respecting public opinion. Instead, they just say what themselves want to say and objecting for the sake of it. Madam Deputy, we have to thank the nation's support in the construction of the XRL so that we can be connected to the national XRL grid and share the economic success. And the central government have taken into account of the Hong Kong circumstances and public concern. The officials from both sides have spent a lot of time negotiating to arrive at their final proposal. Co-location is beneficial to this Hong Kong and with strong public backing. Any rational person should support this. Madam Deputy, for the past 2 days, some members and through quorum calls and who call for a call for quorum and in order to filibuster, resort to every tactic to stall the scrutiny of this bill. They claim to have represented public and disregard the strong public desire for the early commissioning of the XRL, and claiming that the bill is unconstitutional or the allegations of land sessions conduct scaremongering and stand on the opposing side of the public. The opportunities for the Bay Area is presented right in front of us. This Guangzhou-Shenzhen-Hong Kong Street Rail can greatly shorten the travel time within the Bay Area. The one-hour living circle is about to be realized. With the XRL, it will allow us to work and live in different locations. For the commerce and the tourism sector, to also greatly enhance efficiency. It's okay to return to factory visit for the same day. And the ACMB Bridge and the Bay Area will greatly transform our lives. And co-location is a good way to facilitate the public. Therefore, it's worthy of our support. I hope that the opposition members can come to their senses and pass this bill as soon as possible so that allow Hong Kong to embark on a high-speed train of economic development.
Mr. Michael Tian. Mr. President, well, since 2040 to now, well, you can say it's a long time or it's not, but I've been following very closely to that. Since 2014, I became the chairman of the subcommittee on railway matters. So from then on, whatever there's any issue with the XRL, I would always follow up at the first instance. Apart from the XRL construction, there's been much debate too on the co-location arrangement. Many said that you, Michael Tan, kept criticizing the XRL, but then at the same time you expressed support for the co-location arrangement. But I hope you get that I only follow one principle, that is to get things done properly. I believe the XRL is a very important infrastructure for Hong Kong. I've said it many, many times. So to realize the efficiency and benefits of the XRL, that we need co-location. Well, many may have forgotten about this. This is a cross-boundary XRL link with multiple destinations. It's not just a train from A to B, but rather it's from A to B, C, D, E, F, G. So you can only do co-location at the terminus. Otherwise, that means that every city or at every station, there is a need for CIQ facilities. Imagine how can that be possible? This is a unique XRL, is not seen anywhere else. We're not talking about just XRL between two points. It's a multi-destination XRL. No, so if we don't have co-location, it's just not going to work. You might as well just grab the line. Now, what about on-board clearance? So clearance only starts after passing the Shenzhen River. But then from Shenzhen River to West Kowloon is just 10 minutes and there are 600 on board. There will be customs and immigration clearance. It's simply impossible. What about separate location of the cross-boundary facilities? Everybody get off as Futian and then 15 minutes. Every train is 15 minutes and there are 600 people having to go through clearance in 15 minutes. How is it possible? And the trains will be delayed, so it's just not going to work. But that's why those opposing co-locations never come up with any option. At the end, they gave up on those other options because it's simply not feasible. So what do we do then? Do we just scrap the whole XRL line, fill up the holes, and then build on it? in 2014, as the MPC deputy, I made a suggestion to the relevant mainland office, that is at the West Kowloon station, that we could set up a mainland port area within the West Kowloon station. I was among the first to make this suggestion. So this mainland port area is for a specific purpose for applying mainland laws for the purpose of collocation, because in the discussion of collocation arrangement, there's never any mention of setting up a mainland port area. But setting up the MPA itself is against the basic law. We're not talking about just applying mainland laws to Hong Kong, but rather we're talking about setting up a MPA with jurisdictions given to the mainland. Would that be against the basic law? So that's shifted the focus of the controversy. And then with twists and turns, finally, on the 25th of July 2017, the government announced a collocation proposal, and I'm glad to see that their proposal is the same as mine. Now, I've explained the legal basis for collocation. I fully appreciate, of course, that there are people with different views on the legal basis of the collocation bill. So that's why I'm firmly in support of Hong Kong courts having jurisdictions over controversies on the collocation bill, because I'm quite certain that there will be judicial reviews. In a civilized society, disputes must be resolved through judicial means. It's not left to politicians attacking each other here, with some saying it's against, some saying it's not. When the secretary first received an interview, with her first interview in radio, she said the courts have jurisdictions on this judicial review. But then later on in the Bills Committee, when I asked this very straightforward question, somehow the answers became very complicated. And then, I asked this question to the subcommittee. And then somehow the subcommittee chairman said I couldn't ask this question. I don't know why. But anyway, I hope the Secretary for Justice would reiterate again that Hong Kong courts have jurisdictions over such cases. And another thing is about trying to instill confidence in the public and changing public perception. Sorry, how much time do I have, Mr. President? 15 minutes. But many are waiting, so please be concise as soon as possible, as far as possible. Yes, I know that there is need to apply all mainland laws in the MPA, just in case there are wanted felons coming down to Hong Kong. Then they would be able to get away without all mainland laws being applied. Some said that law enforcement could be carried out outside of the MPA, but at the Bills Committee meeting, some have expressed concern that mainland officials may enforce the mainland laws outside of MPA, but the SL government has said it's not definitely not going to be the case, because mainland personnel would not leave the MPA. So it's more a matter of perception. Now, many have expressed concerns about freedoms of expression, speech, receiving information, so on, whether this will be undermined. So again, I'm going by the principle that I want to get things done properly. I wrote to the mainland authorities, to asking them to consider that there should be free Wi-Fi on board all XLR trains. And then to the south of the Shenzhen River, the free Wi-Fi service should not have any filtering of information. This is to make sure of free flow of information within the Hong Kong boundaries. Now, of course, there is a need, and it's reasonable to apply all mainland laws in the MPA. It's a matter of striking a balance with public perception and so on. Recently, there's been some debate about the handling fees for buying XRL tickets. Some say criticize me for supporting XRL, but then criticizing handling fee. But again, it's a matter of it's the principle of getting things done right. So we need to discuss with others the arrangement. Now, if we don't even have collocation, then the China Railway won't even bother to negotiate with you. So it's a matter of egg and chicken, what comes first. we must first sort out a co-location, and then we can talk to the railway corporation on negotiate with them on the handling fees. Now, if there is no, it's not possible to buy tickets on the mainland XRL network, then people might as well just fly to their destinations. Monthly tickets. As MPC deputy, I also wrote letters on that. I hope, therefore, Hong Kong, Shenzhen, and Futian, well, 60% of passengers will be boarding or lighting at these three stations. So hopefully there will be monthly tickets to promote integration with between the two places. Maybe there could also be tax concession for same-day return, so young people could lived in Hong Kong but go to work in Shenzhen and come back on the same day. So going to Shenzhen would be as convenient as going to Yuanlong. 2 days ago, I received a phone call from Mr. X of the Guangzhou Railway Corporation. They said they're considering the various options. They asked what sort of accounts I would like. I said 60%. I tried to, you know, suggest a high discount first. Now, if it's 60%, let's say two trips per day, 22 days a month, that should help. And this Mr. X has promised to consider it. Now, whether I'm able to deliver this option, I don't know, but at least someone from the mainland called and asked what kind of discount I have in mind. So hopefully there will be some good news to share with you later on about monthly tickets, authorization, and not having to pay handling fees and so on. So definitely I'm in support of the co-location bill. Thank you.
Dr. Fernando Zhang, Mr. President, I speak to oppose the resumption of second reading of the Guangzhou-Shenzhen-Hong Kong Express Rail Link co-location bill. However, I must say that I am not against co-location itself. This is a mechanism that will be convenient for passengers. There is no problem. Shenzhen Bay Port, we have this model. It has been put in place for many years. How it works is that an area is designated so that members of the public travel from to and from Hong Kong and Shenzhen can use co-location facilities there. There is no law in Hong Kong that prevents the laws to be enforced there. So that model works, but put it the other way around. If we invoke the same piece of legislation to say that an area should be designated in Hong Kong for mainland laws to be applied for the expediency of the public, it doesn't work because we have the basic law. It is clearly spelled out in Article 18 of the basic law that national laws shall not be applied in Hong Kong. It's that simple. This is a guarantee for Hong Kong people. You can trace back to the time before the handover. We had totally different systems, different legal systems, judicial systems, very different social order. So how could we guarantee that the Hong Kong way of life, our rule of law, our freedom, our social order would remain the same? And even capitalism versus socialism. We wouldn't imagine that the mainland model should be adopted for Hong Kong. This is the core of the basic law. After years of discussion, the CPG ultimately agree that this should be the principle. This is the Constitution of Hong Kong, and definitely, apart from having constitutional status in the mainland, it is also the Constitution of Hong Kong. That is why Hong Kong people feel reassured by this basic promise. One of the promises is that mainland laws will not be applied in Hong Kong. Any public officer in the mainland when coming to Hong Kong must abide by Hong Kong laws. And in no way should these mainland officials enforce the mainland laws in Hong Kong. And this is to show Hong Kong people and the world that it is all right that we have a different system in Hong Kong than the mainland's. But at the same time, we can preserve our own system. We don't need to be afraid of being arrested by a public security official in the mainland and taken elsewhere. And then all of a sudden, I will make confessions in front of the TV audience, admitting to certain crimes. Hong Kong people need not worry because the social order in Hong Kong will not all of a sudden be overtaken by something else. This is our fundamental guarantee and fundamental protection. That is why 10 or 20 years ago, when the idea of express rail link was first floated, we already mentioned that it is extremely difficult to implement co-location in Hong Kong. And back then, the Hong Kong government said, all right, we could think about it. We could think about different options of CIQ procedures, not necessarily co-location. So what happens then? Over the years, civic organizations and the community have been urging the government to rethink, because clearly co-location arrangement is against the basic law and numerous provisions in the basic law, as well as local legislation. And when the issues were raised in 2007, the government said, all right. And in 2010, when the CE in Council gave its approval, when FC approved the funding application, the government even said it's all right. And then they kept playing delaying tactic all the way till 2017 in July. And Mr. Rinsky Yuan, the then secretary, said that the three-step process would be adopted. And that is, the NPC SC will need to make a decision approving and endorsing the cooperation arrangement, and that is step two. So the Secretary for Transport and Housing, Secretary for Security, both of you mentioned that according to Article 20 of the Basic Law, there are other powers granted by the NPC. Well, that idea was floated in July last year, but what happens now? It's completely gone. So you're doing whatever you like. You're not following the basic law. Unless you're suggesting that the NPC has all the say, it is omnipotent, it can change the basic law whatever way it likes, and then interpret the basic law however it likes, then so be it. Otherwise, you have the basic law clearly written in black and white. Why aren't you following the procedures? Secretary, if you're going to break the rules, at least don't be so blatant. And then the bureau chiefs, the department secretaries, all the so-called elites and professionals in the legal sector came up and said that it's all right, and then you refer to Chong Feng Yun, Ka Ling, and also CFA decisions that we should not take a literal interpretation of the law, but rather extrinsic materials. And then after reading all the extrinsic materials, your conclusion is this: when collocation arrangement is put in place for a specific purpose, which is for clearance procedure, and that the scope is not the whole of Hong Kong territory, and then the mainland laws will only be applied within the MPA, it would be all right. But where is it written in the basic law? What's intrinsic, what's extrinsic? What material is available to back your conclusion? Well, I am a lecturer in the university, and if you draw this conclusion without any evidence to support it, I'll definitely fail you, because you're not even a primary level. Well, about the mainland organization, where in the basic law does it say that the mainland organization or mainland body, it's not required to follow the basic law. And then you mentioned that it's up to passengers to decide whether to go inside or not. Then it's too outrageous. Why don't you set up a special economic zone in Central? You can have a mainland stock exchange in Central. You can use it for a special purpose, designate an area for mainland laws to apply there. And then it's up to you whether you go in or not. You can choose not to go in. Can we do that? And then you can have different areas for different purposes, for transport, for business, for financial services. You can do whatever you want. But what happens to the basic law, which is supposed to protect Hong Kong people? Mr. President, you're asking, well, they are asking us to pass a bill that is unconstitutional. That is totally outrageous. And all of you are sycophants. You only listen to the powerful, but at least you should follow some order. You should, because you're already the winner, and you don't even follow the basic rules of the game, of course. In terms of power, you're in control of resources. We are overpowered, and you're in control of flow of information, because you have APIs every day, all the time on TV to mislead the public. You suggest that this is nothing but to make it convenient for the public. When have I said that I'm against that? Why would I be opposed to any infrastructural project that would help improve our transportation system? Well, to facilitate business exchange, cultural exchange, sightseeing, whatever. It's all right, but first of all, we need to ask whether the investment is worthwhile, whether it has any economic or it is cost effective. But setting this aside, what I'm arguing with you is about how you're breaking all the rules for the sake of enactment of this bill, such that you are enacting this bill, which is against the basic law. We simply cannot take this, because we are part of the establishment in this chamber. We must follow the rules. No matter how irrational, how unreasonable these rules are, we follow the rules, because just by the composition of the council, you can see how unreasonable it is. You are in control of the majority here. But still, I need to explain things to the public. The so-called elites in the legal sector, I don't know how they sleep at night. They know that this is unconscious, they know that this is wrong, and still they go ahead with it. Mr. President, how can we debate on the merits of the bill? When you're not keeping up with your fundamental promise, you're not upholding the core basic core values, not to mention that you're misleading the public. You're in control of everything in this chamber, and then you are restricting us in various ways. You impose speaking time limits. You stop us from making any point in our speech so that you can complete the scrutiny of the controversial bill in 3 months, so that the bill will be passed after only 36 hours of deliberation in the council. You can do whatever you like. You have the power. But do some soul searching. What are you going to say to your future generations? Today, what you're doing is all about protecting your own interests and preserving your power. And you've broken rules. Even in the circumstances, when you're already in control of the situation, you are the one making the rules, you dare to break the rules. I don't know whether Hong Kong people will regret, but definitely, I won't be part of your problem. Between the high wall and the egg, I'll always side with the eggs. We are the weaker side, but the truth is on our side as well. We'll continue to explain very clearly that basic law is something that everyone can read for themselves. No matter how you try to twist the argument, there is no way you can be the truth. So go on, let's see how you can explain to the world. How can you explain that although this area is deemed not within Hong Kong territory, it is still in Hong Kong, and then we have international conventions that we must follow, ICCPR, for example, other human right-related conventions. I don't know when the area is part of mainland, when the mainland laws apply, how we're going to follow these international conventions. For example, employment-related issues, employees' rights. I don't know who by then will have to say whether these are reserved or non-reserved matters. This is a monster created by ourselves. And then, in order to make sure that the national policy or the strategic high-speed rail can be implemented, can be commissioned in Hong Kong, that we must have co-location arrangement. And I'm concerned that what Hong Kong pays today isn't only the price of a bickering or a minor quarrel. The Hong Kong SAR government is sacrificing its own fundamental principles, and the CPG is compromising the promises made to Hong Kong people. And what we all pay now is our core values. I don't think anyone can take this responsibility.
Mr. Dennis Kwok, this co-location bill, the crux is the constitutional issues raised at the Bills Committee stage. However, on the constitution issues, we're not able, we don't have the Secretary of Justice with us to listen or to respond to the members' questions. We all know it's all about the constitutional issue. The basic law is a national law promulgated by the Central People's Government and the NPC. Why do you emphasize this a national law? Because the entire nation, no matter which department or officer at which rank, or even the NPCSC, must abide by the central officials at many occasions has stressed that the basic law is a national law. Simply put, the NPCSC, regardless of how high is constitutional status, it must abide by the provisions in the basic law. The Court of Final Appeal in Hong Kong in the proceedings have mentioned that as well. Why now the administration claimed that because the NPCSC had a cooperation agreement with the Hong Kong government, therefore the provisions in the basic law can be disregarded. Some claims that we are the common law practitioners, therefore we could not understand civil law or continental law, which they claim is a different system. However, this is never about, it's never the case. Now we'll talk about the provisions in the set of laws, which the subject is simple enough. Why? The for this set of laws would enjoy a high status in the political system that is not respected by the same institution. For those who have read the submission by the Hong Kong Bar Association, it's not hard to understand. Its rationale is very simple. For Article 18 of Basic Law, we all take a literal approach to interpreting it. Whether it is common law or civil law system, they all rest upon one thing, that we have to abide by the wording and the provisions in the law to interpret it, instead of resort to what we describe as extrinsic materials that's been mentioned at the Bills Committee stage. But what actually are they? For the extrinsic materials, the Bills Committee have made a lot of queries for the government. What sort of extrinsic materials are you relying to interpret the basic law and the cooperation agreement to claim that it's compliant with the basic law? However, we never quite get the answer. During the Bill Committee stage, I've asked the Secretary for Justice, how is this bill compliant with the surveillance provisions in the basic law, especially Article 18 and 22? It's been set out clearly that the national laws, except those listed in Annex 3, they should not apply to Hong Kong. And Article 23, that the central people's government, the department, and its are prohibited to apply the laws of the mainland. These are very clear provisions in the basic law. The Secretary for Justice responded that these provisions are not engaged in the scrutiny of this bill. When I follow on that, she shifted her tone. She said that it's not engaged. It's just that they claim that it's subject to the proportionality test. This is a rather technical legal concept. In simple language, that under some circumstances, let's say freedom of speech is protected under the basic law. However, under some specific circumstances, the government and LegCo can legislate to control and restrict the freedom of speech. However, that's been done very carefully and in a very restricted manner, and also have a proportionate goal. For example, what I said will incite racial hatred. For the law to restrict it, simply to restrict a person's freedom to achieve a specific aim, so in some way it would satisfy the proportionality test. However, some provisions in the basic law would not apply the proportionality test. For example, Article 1 of the Basic Law, the Hong Kong and Special Managed Region is an inalienable part of the People's Republic of China. That could not be violated or restricted. Some of the provisions are absolute in themselves, and which the proportionality tests would not apply. For Article 18, 19, and 22, these are the important principles of the one country, two system, and could not be contravened to a certain extent. And the proportionality test can never apply. Otherwise, all these provisions will enter a gray area. There's so many colleagues. I'm speaking on the impact of the basic law to one country, two system. Their concerns are definitely objective and not objecting for the sake of it. There's plenty of that in the legal field, including those with a diverse political stance, knowing what's really going on. When the drafting of the basic law, we never anticipated this collocation would happen. So we didn't take into account collocation. That doesn't mean that we can distort the provisions in the basic law to achieve something that's legally impossible. A more straightforward approach, if possible, is to amend the basic law. So to make the whole thing become constitutional, instead of trying to slice and dice your provisions, the whole thing is unconstitutional. If the jurisdiction of Hong Kong courts is applicable to an entire Hong Kong, why are we forcibly excluded part of Hong Kong from the jurisdiction powers? That is quite clear in the basic law itself. And now you claim that the mainland port area in the West Kowloon Station is still part of Hong Kong, and yet this jurisdiction of the courts is about to exclude it. So is that part still regarded as part of Hong Kong or not? Is it part of the jurisdiction of Hong Kong or outside of it? As LegCo members, these are important issues for LegCo members to consider and are perfectly reasonable. So when the government submits a blue bill, when it's obvious that some of the rights given to Hong Kong people and some of the safeguards to the one country system that we removed forcefully, our job is to point out the problem is and question the government. Our duty is to hold the government accountable. Even for the post-establishment camp supporting the co-location bill, you have to accept that the Democrats and the legal field to point out some issues are not simply out of the blue, but with sound basis. At the Bills Committee stage, we raised a lot of queries on the legal side. And for the certain parts, we see a clear contravention or with shortcomings. So even we think it was unconstitutional for the majority of those amendments and have been thrown out because the administration claimed that these proposed amendments are out of scope of this cooperation agreement. And therefore, these amendments could not be incorporated into the bill. This is very wrong. If the MPCSC and the Hong Kong government enter into cooperation agreement, or the MPCSC has promulgated an order or directive, the Hong Kong Legislative Council have been instructed to pass this law. So does that mean that we have to passed it intact without any changes or amendments? So what the powers of LegCo under basic law, what's the impact of this? There'll be far-reaching consequences. If the MPCSC has such powers to instruct the LegCo to pass a bill intact without changing anything, Will the Hong Kong people understand that the XOL has a certain economic value? But Is it because of this that would lead the creation of a gaping hole in a one country, two system? And would actually affect the powers of Legco to such extent? Is it what the public had anticipated? Like some claims that there is popular support for the XRL. As a lawmaker, we have higher expectations of ourselves and be more visionary. For something so blatantly contravening the basic law, just because there are over 50% of popular support and would disregard, look the other way, we are simply failing our duty as a LegCo member. When we take the oath, we promise to safeguard the basic law in one country, two system. Well, we made such promise when scrutinizing this blatantly unconstitutional bill, and we refused to say anything owing to public pressure, refused to point out its flaws. That will be irresponsible. Continental law and the common law share the same spirit, that we have to follow the wording of the provisions to interpret the law. That this a universal and core focus of all the legal system worldwide. Today, we're asked to pass a bill on which the premise is to distort the basic law of its most important provisions. As the representative for the legal sector, I wish to adopt a palm tone to put forth the argument. However, with a heavy heart, I'm sitting here to see an unconstitutional bill be passed.
Thank you, Mr. President.